maybe I am a student of history of Indian science and technology, but really in this topic, I am a novice. Only it has been assigned to me, and like a good student, I am trying to write my first essay or whatever. Okay, so it is what I will say. So obviously, the actual topic is the fourth title that we will focus on that. But I'll first say something that the issue of pan-Indianness as regards our scientific tradition is not an issue in dispute. Whereas about many other things, whether India is a nation is a question that scholars have debated in the last 100, 200 years, or whether Hinduism is a single religion or a conglomeration of hundreds of religions is a topic which has been. So, or was India united culturally? Are we culturally a united nation? Or are we something called a composite culture, whatever that may mean? So these have all been debated. But as regards Indian knowledge systems, this issue has not been too much a debatable issue. Of course, first reason is that we do not study any of our knowledge systems seriously as subjects of scholarly study in our institutions of higher learning. We only read them in occasional articles in newspapers and things like that, or we read some special scholarly works. So the civilizational unity of India was a very important issue during our national movement, our movement for independence, and it was very specially emphasized by Mahatma Gandhiji. There was something much more. Historically, a much larger region was thought of as having a civilizational unity with India. I'll say something briefly about it. It was called Greater India by our scholars. Then I will say something about how our scientific traditions did have a pan-Indian character. And finally, I will try to tell you something about the pan-Indian character of our systems of learning, even till the early decades of British rule, that is in early 19th century. And then something about what would we call as the core aspect of Indian science and technology. If there is some philosophical view or a world view, can we speculate by looking at our literature, what do we understand? These will all be very preliminary remarks. Okay. Here is a work, a very beautiful book, written in 1983 by Colin Ronan. He also wrote a shorter Science and Civilization of China. Needham wrote about 14 volumes in several parts. He wrote a two-volume book called Shorter Science and Civilization in China. And he also wrote this Cambridge Illustrated History. And here you can see origins of science, Greek science, Chinese science, Hindu and Indian science, Arabic science, Roman and medieval science, Renaissance, 17th, 18th, 19th, 20th. So Indian science is a composite unit which clearly occurs here. You want me to take up that other mic? Only you can see the number of pages devoted to these are very, very different. Yeah. 60 pages to Greek science, 60 pages to Chinese science, especially because Ronan, as I told you, was a specialist in history of science in China. 40 pages to Hindu and Indian. But even then, this write-up, this part of the write-up is indeed very good, what Ronan has written. If this book is available somewhere, I suggest all of you to take a look at this book. Now this, another book, this by a well-known Indian scholar, Professor Alok Kumar, who also teaches in New York State, like Professor Kim Plofker. He's a physicist in Montgomery. He has written 3-4 books on Indian scientific culture. So here you can see Egypt, Mesopotamia, Indian science, Greek, China, Islam, New World Horizons, more or less somewhat same amount of space given to each of them. Now I come to a very scholarly set of volumes that Cambridge University brought out in the last 7-8 years. A 8-volume history of science. The first volume came out the last. It's on ancient science, edited by 2 very eminent scholars, Professor Alexander Jones in the Institute for Study of Ancient Civilizations in New York University, one of our leading scholars on Greek and Mesopotamian civilizations. So here you can see Mesopotamia, Egypt, Greek and Greco-Roman, India. You can see Professor Plofker appearing here and her colleague Clemency, and China. Again, you can see the great disparity in the amount of space that the editors have allotted. I'm not blaming Professor Plofker. So it's 90 pages to Mesopotamia, 100 pages, 60 pages to Egypt, 320 pages to Greece, India about 60, 50 pages, then 70 pages. China would be about another 70. Islamic science appears in volume 2 of this series, that has about 100 pages. And this ancient period, I think, was confined up to what the Western scholars, in their understanding of periodization of world history, what is called the classical period, ends in around 450 or 500 AD. So this would be up to, I suppose, up to 500 AD. Though Indian science continued beyond the classical period of the Western periodization of world history. What can be called as the classical period of Indian sciences went up to something like 1200 or 1300 of the Common Era. Anyway, the main point to emphasize was that scholars of history of science do think of Indian science as one of the important unified components of knowledge system. Just as Chinese science, the post-Renaissance modern science, or what may be called as Islamic science, or Egyptian science, or science in Mesopotamia. Others which are not mentioned are the Mayans and the Aztecs, and other various peoples. Science would be universal amongst all civilizations. But the documented literature and history is what would make scholars give some associated descriptions and scholarly treatments. But when it comes to Indian civilization as a whole, what may be called the scholarship of last 200 years on India has tended to emphasize the sub-regional, sub-cultural manifestations and variations of Indian civilization much more than the what can be called as the common unifying aspects of Indian civilization. And there are famous statements like unity in diversity. But if people are asked to spell out what is this unity, you after 1 or 2, 3 common sentences, you will find that the scholars start wondering what to be said next. Because that has not been taken as the focus of our study. It is not that the scholars are ignorant, but they have not devoted enough time to this issue. They do believe that there is something unified called Indian civilization. But what it is has not been an issue that we would have liked to study, make one course separately on this, and one course separately on only Professor Danino thought that they are going to make a course on this kind of a thing now. So I should read Mahatma Gandhi. The English have taught us that we were not one nation before, and that it will require centuries before we become one nation. This is without foundation. We were one nation before they came to India. One thought inspired us. Our mode of life was the same. It was because we were one nation that they were able to establish one empire or one kingdom here. The ancestors of ours saw that India was one undivided land, so made by nature. They therefore argued that it must be one nation, arguing thus They established holy places in various parts of India and fired the people of India with an idea of nationality in a manner unknown in other parts of the world. Gandhiji is arguing that our idea of nationhood was much stronger than many other civilizations. Our idea of unity was much stronger. We are naturally made into one civilization by nature. One thought inspired us, and our ancestors thought that this should be one civilization. So geographically, if you see, these are all huge mountains in the north, and there's a great sea below. And so geographically, India is indeed a unified mass, often called a fortress. One very important scholar around the time of our independence, Kingsley Davis, he was basically known as a demographer, but he was a very important sociologist also. This kind of a paragraph you normally do not find in any modern textbook written on India. This was one of the most important textbooks on Indian demography that was written in 1951 by Kingsley Davis, the demography of the population of India and Pakistan. Indian ideas and institutions taken as a whole resemble those of no other people. They have a peculiar shape and flavor of their own. They have tended to transform and absorb any foreign elements that trickled into the region. For India, though politically conquered by outsiders, was never culturally conquered. This peculiar culture has to some degree penetrated and pervaded nearly every part of what is geographically India, etc. Okay, now, I mean, this is just to show that modern scholars do indeed occasionally, this is not the topic of my talk, to try and see whether our sciences did display some civilizational character. So this was just a preamble. But no, historically, there was a much larger region between 7th century to around 12th century. Most of the geographers from West Asia referred to this region as Al-Hind. Al-Hind is only the Arabic name for India. The Greeks borrowed the Persians' name. Persians were among the earliest conquerors of northwestern part of India in 5th century before the Common Era. They gave the name India. The Greeks borrowed that. And so this region was called Al-Hind. It included, of course, Afghanistan, parts of actually Uzbekistan and Turkmenistan, Tibet, parts of Yunnan, Burma, and what we today call as Southeast Asia, and part of Philippines. This is the 9th century temple in Prambanan in Java of the Trimurtis, Shiva, Vishnu, Brahma. This is the 12th century very famous temple in Angkor Wat, in Cambodia. It was part of a very great empire called the Khmer Empire. Of course, that empire collapsed in the end of 13th century. This is a very famous complex in Ayodhya, in Burma, in 15th century. It's in Thailand. I'm sorry. Yeah. Thank you. So now, how did somebody describe this? There are many modern scholars who have written about it, but I thought I will tell you how this larger civilizational region was identified and talked about in history. So this is a quote of a Chinese monk called Yixing. He travels in India between 671 to 695 of the Common Era. He first goes to Sri Vijaya, which is near Palembang in Sumatra, and he studies Sanskrit for 6 months there in Sumatra. And then he comes to India and stays about 12, 13 years here. So he's saying, from the borders of Vietnam to Uzbekistan, people praise the Sanskrit sutras of Panini, the grammar of Panini. So when they're doing it, how much more the people of the divine land, that is China, as well as the Celestial Storehouse of Knowledge India. Those were the names that the Chinese gave to China and India. China was called the Divine Land, and India was called the Celestial Storehouse of Knowledge. So how much more they will be teaching these rules of Sanskrit language of Panini. Grammatical science is called Shabda Vidya, Vyakarana, of which there are five works which are similar to the five great classics that all the Chinese scholars studied. The Sutra is the foundation of all grammatical science, and it consists, this Ashtadhyayi of Panini is roughly about 32,000 syllables. Panini is said to have been inspired and assisted by Maheshwara Deva. Children begin to learn this sutra when they are 8 years old and can repeat all the about 4,000 sutras of this grammar of Panini in about 7-8 months. So this is how this grand civilizational region was described in history. Another example that scholars from all over the world came to this Nalanda University, which was established around 427. And at its height in 17th century, there were 2,000 professors, 10,000 students from all parts of India, and also from China, Tibet, Indonesia, Japan, Korea, Persia, and Turkey. And it had 8 separate groups of buildings, 10 temples, 11 monasteries, hundreds of classrooms, a 9-story library, etc. And endowments were made from kings in Indonesia, etc., to institute professorships here. And there were other places. Nalanda is the most well-known. Vikramashila, Odantapuri, and Vallabhi in Gujarat, Pushpagarhi in Orissa, Somapura in Bengal, etc. And in 11th century, he's quoting the scholar Andalusi. This from this book of Alok Kumar, which I already referred to you. So let us see what Andalusi is saying. Al-Andalusi is an astronomer who was living in Andalus. In Arabia means Spain. Arabic, it means Spain. So he is the astronomer from the Spanish kingdom in Toledo. He has written a book called Book of the Categories of Nations. So there are about 7-8 civilizations or nations that he is describing. And this in 1068. So what they are saying about India, it's not that he is saying derogatory things about other civilizations also. He's saying quite nice things. So don't get carried away that he's saying something extraordinary about India. But still, what he's saying about India is worth looking at. The first nation to have cultivated science is India. This is a powerful nation, having large population. The kings of China refer to the king of India as king of wisdom, that we already saw. India was known as the celestial storehouse of knowledge. To their credit, Indians have made great strides in the study of numbers and of geometry. They have acquired immense information and reached the zenith of their knowledge in the knowledge of the movement of the stars and the secrets of the skies, as well as this, including astrology, as well as other mathematical studies. After all that, they have surpassed all other peoples in their knowledge of medical science and the strength of various drugs, the characteristics of compounds, and the peculiarities of substances. In fact, these are the classical sciences. Yes, yes, these are mathematics, astronomy, medicine, are the classical sciences. In India, to them you add music also and languages also. The study of languages was a study, it was a scientific study, it was an empirical study and a theoretical study. Music is included in the great sciences of the West also, Greeks also. Okay, around the time when Andalusi is writing this, there was a great civilizational sort of discontinuity that came into India, that you can see in this description of Al-Biruni, who is saying that, of course, Sindh was conquered around 715 AD, but it was this marching of Mahmud of Ghazni. Mahmud utterly ruined the prosperity of the country and performed wonderful exploits by which Hindus became like atoms of dust scattered in all directions and like a tale old in the mouth of the people. This is the reason too why the Hindu sciences have retired far away from those parts of the country conquered by us and have fled to places which our hands cannot yet reach, like Kashmir, Benares, and other places. Of course, this is what he's saying at the end of Mahmud of Ghazni's 19 or 20 campaigns in India. This, no, our high, they did go to Benares. Mahmud of Ghazni went to Benares. They did not go to Kashmir, of course. No. So that he thinks that Benares is still like the outreach of what can reach Ghazni's hands. No. Ghazni not merely came and went off. There were many other kings which were re-established, etc. There's another statement which we cannot believe that we used to be like that then. Hindus believe that there is no country but theirs, no nation like theirs, no kings like theirs, no religion like theirs, no sciences like theirs. This is Albertini's description. He must be talking about somebody else, I'm sure. Okay, so now we shall look into some of the science. This is the preamble, what I said, because since I do not have too much to say on the sciences per se, so I had a long preamble. So, first we shall start with the languages. Now, what I'm going to do is, really I'm not going to tell you these are the principles of our science of language, and this was studied, this principle was developed here, this principle. I'm only giving you a list of names, and wherever we know something about where these people were, or wherever we know something about in what language this was written down, I will indicate that to show you the diversity and the geographical and linguistic expanse of that scientific subject in India. This is all I can do at this stage. Maybe after a couple of years when we study the subject, we'll be able to say more. So this science of language is very old in India. This B is wrong. I am prior to 500 of the Common Era, first. So the earliest study of language was in the Vedas. The Vedas recitation was made into Padapatha, Jatapatha, Kramapatha. This led to the study of phonetics. And these texts, Pratishakya and Shiksha texts, are texts of phonetics. Yaskas, Nirukta, these are all pre-Paninian. Panini himself mentions about 10 grammarians, like Shakalya, Apishali, Indra, Kashakrishna, Shakatayana. Then another pre-Paninian grammarian is Vyadi. And Panini is roughly around 500 before Common Era or even earlier. He is said to come from a place called Shalatura in Kandahar. It is in the border of Afghanistan and Pakistan. Panini wrote this Ashtadhyaya, which in 400 sutras encompass the entire language of Sanskrit. It does not describe the words of Sanskrit. What it does is, along with this, there is something called the Dhatupata, which are the root verb forms. From these root verb forms, with various affixes and suffixes added, how to generate words, and how through words sentences have to be generated. This entire Panini's grammar is a generative grammar. It generates like computer science production rules. And in fact, the basic production rules of computer science are called Panini backhouse form by many computer scientists today. Okay. Katyayana wrote a Vartika. He is said to be a Dakshinatya. Tadhita Priyaha Dakshinatya is what Patanjali says about Katyayana. Patanjali is the great grammarian who wrote the most detailed commentary or first detailed commentary on Panini's grammar. Then there are other systems of grammar, Katantra, Chandra, Jainendra. Bhartrhari is a philosopher of language who flourished around 450, said to be the same Bhartrhari who wrote the famous Niti Shataka and things like that. This Vakyapadiya, he also wrote a commentary on Mahabhashya of Patanjali. That we are not clear. In fact, there's a Katyayana who writes the Pali Vyakarana. There's a Katyayana who has written the Vartika on Panini's grammar. We don't know. Then Jayaditya Vamana wrote the first ordinary commentary on Panini's grammar. It's called Kashika Vritti. It was studied in Kashi, but whether Jayaditya and Vamana came from there, we don't know. So about this entire period, we know something about Panini, something about Katyayana. We really don't know, or I don't know, where the rest of the persons come from. There is an ancient Pali Vyakarana. The Tamil grammar of Tolkapiyar is dated definitely prior to 500 of the Common Era. Of course, it can be much earlier. The available version must be later. Pingala is empty, but I am not counting him. I am talking of Vyakarana only. The one important thing that became pan-Indian was this. The sounds, even much prior to Panini, while in the Pratishakyas and in the Shiksha texts, in the phonetics texts of India, the sounds were classified into vowels and consonants, and they were classified on the basis of the place where the sound is articulated. The sound is articulated from the throat to the lips. Kanthya, Talavya, Dantya, Oshtya, and Kanthya, Talavya, Murdhanya, Dantya, and Oshtya. These are the points where the sound is produced. Then Ghosha, Aghosha means voiced and unvoiced. Then Nasal, Adunasika. Then these are called Antasthas and Ushmas. And so they are classified by Sthana and Prayatna, the place where the sound comes and the effort you are supposed to make. Now, this classification of sounds. So you take any Indian alphabet today, it starts like I, E, U, U, etc. And then Ka, Kha, Ga, Gha, Ga, etc. So this was something extraordinarily characteristic of India. But it was not only characteristic of India, it was characteristic of very, very large cultural region, which includes Kharoshthi, Kothani, Tibetan, in Nepali, modern scripts of India, excepting Urdu, Persian, Sinhalese, Burmese, Khmer, Thai, Javanese, Balinese. And even later in Japan, a Hiragawa and Katakana methods, alphabets were taken up. And Korea made the most perfect script, Hangul, developed in 1444. This by Fritz Stahl in a very beautiful article in this Blackwell Companion to Hinduism. And in the end, he says, all these Asian scripts are a far cry from the haphazard jumble of the ABC and the countless spelling problems that come from it in English and other modern languages that use these alphabets. So where do these ABC come from? Once again, where do these ABC come from? They ultimately go back to what is called the Phoenician alphabet of around 1200 BC. From that, the Hebrew and the early Greek alphabet came. And from that, later on, the Latin and Cyrillic alphabets came. And that's the mother or father of all the later European alphabets. So the Indian alphabets are based upon the phonology of the sound. Yes, sir.
So, sir, was this kind of a classification also applicable for the ancient Tamil?
Yes, yes. Ancient Tamil also is the same. Only it does not have the voice, the thing separately. It does not have a symbol. Tamil has the ka sound and the ga sound also. But it uses in orthography only ka for that. Because you can make out from the word where the word occurs, whether it is to be pronounced as ka or as ga, as regards original Tamil words. But if you take a non-original Tamil word, like Padma, they can pronounce it as Batma. So that is possible. But original Tamil words, you can, like in Arabic alphabet, the vowels were not there at all. What is called the original Arabic alphabet, the vowels were inferred. Kitab and Katab were all written in the same way. Later on, some symbols were started for vowels. So it applies for Tamil also. Aspirates are? The Kha and the Gha are not there. Yes. And it has extra Ra and extra Ya and all that Tamil alphabet. Malayalam has that. But that can be brought in under this scheme. It's just you can add those sounds here. Even language, sounds of other languages can be incorporated to this scheme and it can be made bigger. In fact, there's a theory that Subhash Kak says that Mendeleev's periodic table was inspired by this because Mendeleev was a great scholar of Sanskrit. Okay. Now, later classical period. Now we have various, initially, commentaries on commentaries. So first is Kashika Vivarana Panjika is on the Kashika commentary on Ashtadhyayi. Kayata is from Kashmir. He wrote a commentary on Mahabhashya of Patanjali. Helaraja is again from Kashmir. He wrote a commentary on Vakyapadiya. Vakyapadiya, as I said, is a text on philosophy of grammar. Raja Bhoja, he is in Dhar in near Ujjaini. Dharmakirti was a Ceylonese Buddhist scholar. He wrote a commentary on Pani's Vyakarana. Bhoja also wrote on astronomy, a work called Raja Mrigangka. He wrote on architecture, a work called Samarangana Sutradhara. He wrote other works. Hemachandra is a very great scholar from Gujarat in Patan. He is called a polymath because he not only did mathematics but hundreds of things. So this Siddha Hemachandra and Prakrita Shabdanushasana are the two most important works on grammar. One is on Prakrita and one is on Sanskrit. Bopadeva's Mukta Bodha was popular in Bengal. Now, from about 800 of our common era, grammars, if not grammars, more books on rhetorics started being written in Indian languages. We saw on Pali and Prakrit works were written even earlier, and Tamil grammar, Tolkapiyam I mentioned earlier. But now these are all the grammars. Tamil had Veerasholiyam, Nannul, Kannada had Karnataka Bhasha Bhushana, Shabdamani Darpana of Keshi Raja, Telugu Andhra Shabda Chintamani, Andhra Shabda Dushasana. Then Pali had Katsayana Vyakarana, Saddha Nitya Agavamsha from Burma, Prakrita Prakasha Bhararuchi. Bhararuchi again is a name we don't know when he was, where he is from. So all these grammars are in the Paninian framework. That's the more important thing. They use the Paninian concepts, and then they will give you where this language differs from Sanskrit language at various points, either in grammatical rules or in sounds or in combining sounds or in adding affixes and suffixes or even in things like gender and other things. Now, a later period, Panini's grammar, if you had learnt it by heart and worked upon it in the same order, it was a great mental exercise. But people wanted more simpler written down grammar which will tell you how to derive words. So Prakriya text started being written. So one of the earliest Prakriya texts is that of Ramachandra. The most famous of these Prakriya texts is what is called Siddhanta Kaumudi, the Moonlight of the Siddhanta by Bhattoji Dikshita. But another very important Prakriya text is by this great philosopher who wrote Narayaniya, Melaputur Narayana Bhattatiri. So he wrote a Prakriya text called Prakriya Sarvasva. He was a student of a great astronomer called Achyuta Pisharati. Kaundabhatta, Bhattoji Dikshita, they are all originally from Maharashtra, partly stayed in Kashi. Kaundabhatta moved to Keladi. Keladi is a famous kingdom in western Karnataka in the Sahyadri Mountains. Nagesha Bhatta is considered one of the greatest scholars of 18th century. He wrote on Nyaya, Vyakarana and Mimamsa, and he even wrote a commentary on Ramayana. He is originally from Satara, but he settled in Prayag and Kashi. And in the later period also, several many more commentaries and works were written on grammars of Indian languages. There was even a Persian grammar written in the Paninian style. Paninian style doesn't mean only sutras, using Panini's concepts. There are many concepts in Panini, which is the concept of Karaka, the concept of Vibhakti, the concept of Lakara, all these things. Parsi Prakasha was written in Akbar's court by Krishnadasa Mishra. And there were grammars of Kannada written in Sanskrit. Earlier there were grammars of Telugu also written in Sanskrit and things like that. Okay. Now let's move to astronomy. Again, in the most ancient period, we cannot locate most of the things. There's a whole lot of astronomical information in the Vedic corpus. Just to give you one example, the pole star, we know that is near the current pole star, which has been the pole star for the last 300 years, was not the pole star at all earlier than that. In fact, there was no star near the celestial pole. The Earth spins on an axis, and that axis points towards some point in the sky. If there is a star at that location, then you call it the pole star. So the pole star about 2800 BC was called Abhaya Dhruva. It was a star in the, it is called Alpha Draconis in today's this thing. And this is mentioned in Taittiriya Aranyaka, the 14 stars of the Draconis constellation, with Abhaya Dhruva as the pole star, is mentioned in a text called Taittiriya Aranyaka. So this would have been an observational point. Whether Taittiriya Aranyaka was written in 2800 BC is not important. Taittiriya Aranyaka is recording an observation made in 2800. They gave me several such information, and the basic concepts of our calendar, all of them, one can trace it to Vedic Samhitas. Then from the archaeological sites of the Indus Valley and various other archaeological sites, you will get a lot of ideas about our astronomical knowledge. One of the earliest texts is Parashara Tantra. From the knowledge of the solstices and equinoxes mentioned there, that can be traced to about 1300 BC. The text may not have been written there, but it mentions that the solstice, summer solstice, begins with some star, sun passing some star, and from that you can date the text. The same thing is true about Vedanga Jyotisha. From the position of the solstices it mentions, those correspond to about 1200 to 1300 BC. But Vedanga Jyotisha is a very algorithmical text, tells you how to calculate the tithi or nakshatra on the average in a 5-year cycle. Then we have the famous Shulva Sutras, which give constructions for all various planar geometrical figures in their transformations. Then we have another text called Vruddhagargiya Jyotisha, which is being now studied by various scholars in India and abroad. These are some of the ancient texts. And as I can see, I have not been able to geographically locate. Vedanga Jyotisha is supposed to be by Lagadha, but beyond that, we don't know. Then we see the influence of Ashtadhyayi and Pingala's Chandas in our astronomy texts. There are several Jaina and Bauddha texts which also deals with astronomical and mathematical information. One of the earliest texts is something called Chandra Vakyasa Bhararuchi, and this Bhararuchi has been dated by Professor K.V. Sharma to be around 300 of our common era, and he is from Kerala. One of the most well-known dated texts of India is the Aryabhatiya Aryabhatta. In 108 verses, it discusses both mathematics and astronomy. Aryabhatta is called Ashmakiya. This Ashmaka, some people think, is in the banks of Gujarat. Some people think it is in northwestern India. But he was a Kulapa in Kusumapura. Kusumapura is the name for Patna, Pataliputra. So all our standard computational procedures in arithmetic, algebra, geometry, trigonometry, more or less taught in our schools, can be traced to Aryabhatiya. And some most of our simple algorithms for astronomical computations can also be traced to Aryabhatiya. Of course, it's a very terse text that it can contain all this in 108 verses. So it will have to have commentaries and all that. One of the most well-known commentaries by Bhaskara, who is coming from Vallabhi in Gujarat. He was not a direct student of Aryabhatta. He is mentioning various students of Aryabhatta. Bakshali Manuscript, its dating is a controversial topic. Professor Plofkar is one of the authorities on the subject. It can be anywhere between 3rd to 9th century. It was found near Peshawar. And this is actually a calculational manual in arithmetic and algebra. So it has various symbols, equations, I mean, in those forms, in their original format, problems, solutions. Now, one of the most crucial things is the place value system. And you can more or less trace its evolution, but you cannot fix its exact date of discovery. The Vedic texts, not only do they name powers of 10, but in all Indian languages, if you say 123, ekshau battis. So if you say in Sanskrit, ekashata trivimshati. So while stating it itself, you are saying it according to the place value. So it has a place value nomenclature. Zero and infinity, you can trace the ideas to various philosophical discussions in Upanishads. But more concretely, Panini's Ashtadhyayi has a, while moving one sound to another, it will say, now you take away this sound, in that place there is an emptiness. So that is called lopa. But it is not just emptiness, it is emptiness created out of removing a particular sound. So the later operations you do depend upon the fact that that sound stayed there. So it's a very complex, it's called zero morpheme in modern linguistics. Then there is the idea of shunya in the Buddhist and Nyaya philosophy, Abhava in Nyaya and Shunya. Then the first word, first time the word Shunya appears in a scientific text is in Pingala's Chanda Sutra, where he is using Shunya as a symbol, not as a number. He is describing a calculation, actually in binaries. And he is describing that if this happens, you put a zero symbol there. Whether zero was known as a number at that time, we don't know. Now there are many philosophical texts, some of them dated, some of them not dated, which tell you the place value principle. I mean, this is one standard quotation. Yatha eka reka, shata sthane shatam, dasha sthane dasha, eka cha eka sthane, yatha cha ekatve pistri, mata cha uchyate, duhita cha swasa chet. Meaning, just as one woman is known as mother, daughter-in-law, and daughter, depending on the relation, in the same way, a symbol, if it is in 100 place, it will tell you, carry the value 100. If it's in the unit place, it will carry the value unit. So it had pervaded, the idea of the decimal place value system had pervaded the culture that it was part of philosophical discussion. Now the current today, all calculational procedures, addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, square, square root, cube root, you find in Aryabhatta's Aryabhatiya, more or less in the way that we teach them today in our schools. This is 499 AD. Now, since we wrote mathematics in language also, and mostly in verse form, it would be useless to put in the number words within the verse. The verses will become very complex. So various devices were created. One is called the Bhuta Sankhya, that you call numbers by some object. So if you say Chandra, one. If you say ice, two. If you say Agni, three. If you say Veda, four, like that. Then there was something called the Katapayadi system, that the square of consonants, ka ka ga ga nga, cha 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 cha, that is used to code numbers. So these were all very beautiful and standard systems. They were in place by about 6th century. But written form of numerals using place value and including zero in inscriptions occur in India only after 7th century. They do occur in Southeast Asia in 7th century. This is the inscription in Gwalior. This is 270. But commentary of Bhaskara in 629 is telling you number 6 followed by 0, followed by 3, followed by 4. So obviously written forms must have been known when Bhaskara's Aryabhatiya Bhashya was written in 629 AD, but we do not have a dated inscription in India with number symbols and zero. But by 662 AD, the world had known decimal place value system to have been an Indian invention. Here is the Syrian bishop, Sebokht. He is saying that Greeks should not think that they have invented all knowledge. If those who believe because they speak Greek that they have reached the limits of science should know these things, they should be convinced that there are also others who know something. I don't know why he is saying all that. But the main thing is, but by nine signs, Indians are doing all calculations. And in 11th century, Ibn Sina is a very famous philosopher, scientist also, has written a great book on medicine. He is saying that his father asked him to learn the place value system from a vegetable vendor, because place value system is the thing which makes calculation almost trivial, that the entire society can adopt mathematical calculation. And of course, in modern times, Newton says, since this doctrine of species has the same relation to algebra, that the doctrine of decimal numbers, and he's saying, this recently established doctrine of decimal numbers, I mean, that in Newton's time in Europe, the place value system was called a recently established. This is in the context of a tract on infinite series that he wrote. And of course, this is a famous quotation of Laplace, that the place value system is a great contribution. Okay. The another thing which we do not know that much is the calendar of India. This is also a pan-Indian system. And the basic ideas of solar year, lunar month, intercalary month, 27 nakshatras, 18-year eclipse cycles, many of them can be traced to the Vedic corpus. The main thing about Indian calendar is that It's based upon observed astronomical phenomena and not just on conventions. Not just a year is 365 days, no. The time taken by the sun to go from one star and again come back to the same star is called a sidereal year. It is 365.25636. The time taken by sun to start from equinox, people who know about equinox, I will not have time to explain what it is, and come back to equinox is called a tropical year. That's the year that we currently use, that is slightly less because this equinox moves at the rate of 50 seconds per year. Indians used to use the sidereal mostly, but they knew about the equinox. Lunar month is the time interval between a conjunction of sun and moon as observed from the center of the earth to the next conjunction of sun and moon. So that is Amavasya to Amavasya, that is 29.5306. And the angle between sun and moon, if it changes by 15 degrees, one tithi is passed. So these are all observational phenomena. The nakshatra is the constellation in which the moon is located. So these are the Indian calendar. But there are various calendrical systems in India. I will not go into detail. There's the solar calendar, where the year starts when sun enters what is called Mesha Rashi. There are two definitions of this Mesha Rashi today. Both must have come in tradition. One is that the beginning of Mesha Rashi is 180 degrees from the star Spica, Chitra. Another definition of the beginning of Mesha Rashi is the star Revati, that's called the Zeta Piscium. So this solar calendar, and when sun moves from one Rashi to another in this fixed zodiac, it starts from Revati, next 30 degrees, next 30 degrees. When sun moves from one to another, is called a solar month. And crossing of that is called a Sankramana. And this solar calendar is followed in Punjab, Haryana, Assam, Bengal, Orissa, Tamil Nadu, Kerala. Then there is lunisolar calendar. Portion of this lunisolar calendar is also followed in these states also. Here, the year starts with a lunar month. A lunar month either begins with a Amavasya in some convention. In another convention, it begins with a Purnima. So the Amavasya convention is held in Andhra, Karnataka, Maharashtra, Gujarat. The Purnima convention is held in Rajasthan, Jammu, Kashmir, Himachal, UP, Bihar, Madhya Pradesh. And the beginning of the year is that lunar month which contains the sun's crossing the Meshadi. And obviously 12 lunar months is less than a year. A lunar month is 29.53 days. So it's about 11 days shorter than the solar sidereal year. So you'll have to have an adhikamasa. The rule is a month, a lunar month, in which there is no crossing of the sun from one Rashi to other is called a adhikamasa. These are all observational based on the true position of the sun and moon. And so that's the nature of the calendar. And this calendar was not only followed in India, it was largely followed in Southeast Asia, also till about 14th, 15th century, in many places of Southeast Asia, even today. Yes, sir.
Hello. So, given that the Sankranti kind of a calendar is always based around 13th or 14th of every month, or 14th or 15th of every month, whereas our core days, like of the shortest day or the longest day, where that actual transition of the hemisphere happens, is around 21st or 22nd. So why that kind of discrepancy had been, like that kind of mismatch had been taken in our solar
equinox
system?
Sun crosses the equinox at March 21. The Gregorian calendar is so fixed that the sun crosses the equinox on March 21st. Now, our beginning of the Mesha Rashi is 23 degrees in some small amount from the equinox. This is called the Ayanamsha. So that is why the solar year for us begins around April 14, 15. After 70 years, it will become April 15, 16. After another 70 years, it will become April 17, 18, like that. So around 500 AD, it used to be close to March 20th. More details we can discuss later. Now, from the classical period, Brahmagupta is from Bindamal in Rajasthan. He wrote Brahmasputra Siddhanta and Khandakadhyaka. He wrote down the mathematics of zero and negative numbers. He developed algebra, second order interpolation. The works of Brahmagupta and Aryabhatta were translated in the Baghdad court in 8th century. Vyacharya Nibandana of Haridatta is from Tirunavaya in Kerala. Karna Ratna of Devacharya is from Kerala. Sridhara wrote a book on Patiganita, arithmetic and geometry, in Bengal. Govinda Swami wrote commentaries and original works in Kerala. Ganita Sara Sangraha Mahaviracharya is the first book. Earlier books were all mostly mathematics contained in astronomy works. This was the first work which is purely on mathematics alone. Sridhara's Patiganita, of course, if you, but whether that is before or later is a matter of dispute. This was in Manyakheta, capital of this Manke. This is a fairly large work. Then again, various commentaries, Pruthudaka Swami in Sthaneshwara in Haryana. Bhateshwara wrote, this is actually the biggest treatise of astronomy. Because he was a Gujarati, he could write 2,500 verses, Siddhanta in Vadnagar, in Gujarat. And Aryabhatta to Shripati is from Rohini Khanda. There are two views whether this is central India or Bengal. Jayadeva place not known. Shatananda from Puri. And various things, the further corrections to motion of moon, better equations of time, the Chakravala method for solving the equation that Brahmagupta had proposed, all these things were there. There was a separate series of mathematical ideas and techniques. The Shulva Sutras itself are not texts of the Vedanga Jyotisha. They are actually texts of what is called Kalpa, which was the performance of Yajnas. And later on, mathematics appears in texts of Chandas, and of course, texts of music, texts of architecture, etc. Now we all have heard of Bhaskaracharya. He wrote his works in 1150. He was in Vijayawada in Sahyadri region. His three works became the very standard works. They became the standard textbooks of both mathematics and astronomy. Lilavati has arithmetic and geometry. Bijaganita has algebra. Siddhanta Shiromani is on both Grahaganita and Gola, that is mathematical astronomy. So Lilavati became very popular work. This is from a current article of S.R. Sharma. 600 manuscripts of this work are there. They are written in all the different scripts of India, thus testifying that the work was studied in all the regions of India. You should remember that in India, Sanskrit was spoken, of course, but when it was written in the local script. So here it would be in Gujarati, it would be in Devanagari, in Kashmir it would be Nandanagari or Nagari, in Bengal it would be Bengali, Oriya, Malayalam, Grantham. So it will be about, maybe there more than 30, 40. And in Southeast Asia, it was written in their scripts. Now in 1587, Akbar ordered Faizi to translate this. And he had to make use of astronomers from Deccan to help him in doing this job. Now, mathematics work started being written in all regional languages. This Pavaluri Ganitam is actually a translation of Ganita Sara Sangraha Mahavira, written in Telugu by Pavaluri, that is place, Pavaluri, Mallana in Andhra Pradesh. Mallikarjuna Suri is again from Andhra. He wrote a Telugu commentary on Surya Siddhanta. Vyavahara Ganita is in Kannada. There's another Leelavati, that's not a translation of Bhaskara's Leelavati, that is done by Raja Aditya in Kannada. And then lots of works start appearing. So this kind of information is available. I'm taking it from a very famous History of Indian Astronomy and Astrology Literature by David Pingree. So this is the genealogy of Bhaskara, starting from Trivikrama. Bhaskara's, whatever, 1, 2, 3, 4, fifth generation elder was in Ujjain. He was honored by Paramara Bhojaraja, whom I mentioned, Raja Bhoja, in Dhar. Govinda, Prabhakara, Manoratha, Maheshwara, then Bhaskara, his son Lakshmidhara, his son Changadeva. It's in an inscription of the time of Changadeva. By then they have come to Devagiri. He is an astronomer in the court of Yadava Singhana in Daulatabad at Devagiri. This inscription maintains mentions all this. Bhaskara himself only talks, I think, about Maheshwara. Now, continuing the mathematics story, there is something called the Vakya system, which became very prominent in whole of South India. Original work perhaps is from Kanchipuram. Ganita Sara Kaumuni is a Prakrita work. It is by Takar Peru. He was in Delhi, actually. I have not mentioned. It's 1300. This Ganita Kaumuni is an extraordinary work. It's about three times the size of Lilavati and much more detailed in content. We don't know where Narayana Pandita hails from. Maybe somewhere in North India because of the manuscript availabilities. But there are scholars who believe he was from South India. Yantra Raja is a work on the Arabic astrolabe instrument. Its origin goes back to the Greek instrumentation. He's from Delhi. Makaranda Sarini is one of the table texts. Professor Plofkar has a book on Sanskrit tables in astronomy. He's from Kashi. Then these are people in North India. I mean, from a Chennai person's point of view. These are actually, most of them are from Western India who have settled in Kashi. Gyana Raja, Surya Dasa, Ganeshi Daivajna. Ganeshi Daivajna stayed there only. His descendants went to Kashi. This is in Nandigrama, Nandagaon. He wrote very important works. Krishna Daivajna wrote a commentary on Bhaskara's Bijagadita. He was in the court of Jahangir in Delhi. Many of them are commentaries with proofs and all that. So this is a large body of work. Then in 17th century, there arose several scholars who engaged with the Islamic astronomical and mathematical tradition. Nityananda wrote a Sanskrit version of a Islamic astronomical treatise. He was in Delhi. Munishwara, Kamalakara, they were in Kashi. There are very important works written by them. Then we all know of Raja Jai Singh, who built the famous five observatories in Jaipur, Mathura, Delhi, Varanasi, and Ujjain. He called scholars from all over India. He got Jagannath Pandita from Andhra, and he got Islamic astronomers, he got Jesuit astronomers, and he sent people to other courts to discuss. So these are some of the kind of genealogies that are available of each of them. This is the genealogy of Gyana Raja and Surya Dasa. This is the genealogy of this Ganesha Daivajna. His father was also an astronomer. These are all the works written by them. This is the genealogy of this from the Golagrama. This is from Nandagaon, this group. This is from Golagrama. This is also on Godavari. But these people are all settled in Kashi. Ranganatha, Kamalakara, and Divakara. These are all their works. This is the Dadigrama on Payoshni River. This is in Vidarbha region. These are all settled. Bhujishwara is in Kashi. Okay, this is the Jaipur observatory of Raja Jai Singh. There was another very great tradition of astronomy in the medieval period called the Kerala school. Madhava was the originator. And then Parameshwara, then Nilakantha Somayaji. This school did two most important things. Madhava discovered and proved infinite series for pi, sine, cosine, which today go by the name of Leibniz, or which go by the name of Madhava, Newton, Leibniz, things like that, Gregory, etc. Nilakantha Somayaji came up with an alternative planetary model in which the interior planets go around the sun. The exterior planets, meaning Jupiter, Saturn, and Mars, go around the Earth, they go around the Sun also. Whereas Mercury and Venus, that is the crucial thing, they don't go around the Earth. They go around the Earth, they seem to go around the Earth because from the Earth you see the Sun going around and Mercury and Venus are going around the Sun. That's how all traditional astronomers thought of it. And Nilakantha Somayaji arrived at it not because of an argument whether Sun should be the center of the universe or Earth should be the center of the universe. He looked at the latitudinal motion, meaning the plane in which Earth moves around the Sun is called the ecliptic. The plane in which the planets move is inclined to it. So the planets have a longitudinal motion and a latitudinal motion. So for Mercury, in 88 days, it goes around the Sun It does not complete 360 degrees around the earth. But in latitude, it goes once up and down. So it's by that kind of an argument he was able to arrive at that. Then this school continued. This Yukti Bhasha of Jyeshtadeva is in Malayalam. Pardon me? Epicycles are there from Aryabhatta's time. Yes. Jyeshtadeva's work in 1530 is called Yukti Bhasha. It's called the, today it's recognized as the first textbook of calculus. So the first textbook of calculus does not appear in Sanskrit, but appears in Malayalam. Of course, it's a highly Sanskritized Malayalam, but in Europe, works were started being written in regional languages around 1550. I think there's an algebra written around 1540 or so. Then in early 16th century, we have Galileo writing in Italian, Francis Bacon writing in English. Even Newton wrote all his earlier works in Latin. Only his Optics was written in early 18th century in English. But Latin continued to be the language till about the time of Gauss's Disquisitione in early 19th century. And one generation before me, all scholars used to study, who wanted to study physics or mathematics, used to study German. And about three generations earlier, scholars who wanted to study mathematics used to study French. And in the last 50, 60 years, scholars who want to study are Hindi. This is called by Sheldon Pollack the era of English cosmopolis. It is the Americanism and global English. And he says, here was Sanskrit, which for 2 millennia enjoyed a very large cosmopolis. For about 2000 years, Sanskrit enjoyed the kind of dominance of intellectual discourse that English enjoys today. And this has been so for the last 70, 80 years. And it may not last beyond another 50 years. We don't know. This is the genealogy. You wanted to say something, sir? Sorry.
You mentioned some name about this.
Sheldon Pollack. He has written a book called Language of Gods in the World of Men in 2005. It's a very masterly treatise of the history of Sanskrit language. Whether one agrees with him or not, one should read the book. This is the genealogy of the Kerala astronomers, and this is the enormous amount of work. This didn't stop with this Narayana or Achyuta. They are early 17th century. There are many more who come later. This is about Ganita Yukti Bhasha. It has a very systematic exposition of all the mathematical results that were known, including their proofs in a systematic way. And it is also, similarly in astronomy, it derives all the results of spherical trigonometry used in astronomy. Now, in 18th century, in various parts of India, the European observers could see Indian astronomers, even in villages or in small places, calculating eclipses. And those calculations were fairly accurate, up to a couple of minutes and things like that. They compared fairly with the tables that they were aware of. This Ligentil is a very famous French traveler who was going to Southeast Asia to observe the transit of Venus. He comes to Pondicherry in Tamil Nadu. Similarly, John Warren sees somebody calculating. There were actually descendants of the Kerala school even in writing books in 1819. Sadratnamala, it's been published, translated, etc. Chandrasekhar Samanta was an astronomer in Puri who was following the Indian system of astronomy. And he found discrepancies between the texts that he was using and the observation. So he made improvements. And in the process, he had something like a Tycho Brahe kind of a model and a better theory of the lunar motion. His book was written in 1869, published in 1899. I will not have time to discuss Ayurveda. I think I will skip Ayurveda. It will just not be proper on my part. I mean, really not much is known about the locality of the place of the person, that much, to the extent I know something about the astronomer. So we'll skip this. So in late 18th and early 19th century, what the British administrators observed was there was a vast network of schools and what they called as colleges or institutions of higher learning which functioned in India. And the common way in which they would say was almost every village had a school. And this was provided for by a certain charge upon the produce of the soil and other endowments in favor of the village teachers, who are thereby under public servants of the community. So there was a fiscal system which supported this indigenous education, which was, so to say, completely demolished by the British. So in one of the famous statements in the Bombay Presidency is of Prendergast, who says in 1821 that in every village there's a school which teaches everybody how to read, write, and calculate, and do commercial calculations and things like that. Similarly, there was a survey of schools in colleges in Madras Presidency that found about 11,575 schools and 1,094 colleges. And Thomas Monroe was the governor, concluded that about one third of the male population of the school going age was studying in these schools for at least 5 years or more. And if you include those people who were given education in their own home, this became even one third of the boys of the school going age. And another thing that they found out was about 65% of all the students were not coming from these communities whom we call as Dvijas, the Brahmana, Kshatriya, and Vaishya. So about 65% of all the students were either from the Shudra or what are called the other castes, the scheduled castes and the scheduled tribes of that period. And this is all, these records are all republished in this book of Dharampal called The Beautiful Tree. And about higher learning, there were these 1,094 colleges where the law, astronomy, they were taught. And then, of course, the collector of Bellary says, earlier these were all supported by grants, either from the village or from a larger king. But today we are not giving them anything. This is in 1820s. There is a similar survey of five districts in Bengal. Why I am saying all these surveys is because now you see the pan-Indian character of this education system. So I talked about, there's a survey of Bombay Presidency also. So there's Adam's survey in five districts of Bengal. I'm not giving the school data. Out of 2,500 scholars in colleges or institutions of higher learning, 1,400 were studying grammar, 400 were studying logic, 336 were studying law, like that. So, and the books they were studying were actually very important books of Panini's school or the Nyaya school in the way that was being developed in 17th and 18th century. These are the works of Raghunatha Shiromani, Mathuranatha. These are the famous Navya Nayayikas, Gadadhara. And the Dharmashastra texts were of Raghunandana. This Vedanta texts were of the 17th century Vedanta texts. And in grammar, it was Kaundabhatta, Bhattoji Dikshita. So this was the system of higher learning that was still being practiced, which did not have the support of the state. But the society still thought it was valuable and continued to support it even under the times of dire distress. The public fiscal arrangements that were made for these institutions had been destroyed by them. There is this famous report on this Navadvipa University in 1791. So in this, they say there are about 1,100 students and 150 teachers. And then they say in 1680, there were 4,000 students and a proportionate number of teachers in this. Navadvipa was the center of this new system of logic, Navya Nyaya. Okay. Now, I just wanted to say that this Indian learning, from what we see today in various manuscripts, there's a very large number of manuscripts in India, about 10 million is a kind of estimate. They are in all sorts of languages. 80% of them are, of course, in Sanskrit, but they are in all our languages. Gujarati, Tamil, Kannada, Malayalam, Persian, Hindi are important, Malayalam. I mean, this is those manuscripts whose name appears in some catalogue of some library. This is not all the manuscripts, it's only about 10 lakh of them. There are said to be several million manuscripts of Indian knowledge. And how they were distributed over various subjects may be seen for the case of Tamil. The Tamil University made a study. So it appears that about one-third of the manuscripts are on religion and about one-third of the manuscripts on literature, drama, music. And the rest of one-third is on various shastras, technical subjects, and of which medicine occupied a very high role. Such a study has not been made for Sanskrit, but for Sanskrit manuscripts in Kerala and Tamil Nadu, late Professor K.V. Sharma found that out of 150,000 that he surveyed, about 12,000 were on these sciences. And so there is a vast storehouse of knowledge which was written in terms of texts, etc. The textual corpus of sciences in India is indeed enormous. Now, if you go to astronomy and mathematics itself, Professor Pingree estimated that the manuscripts on astronomy, Jyotish Shastra, including astrology, was about a lakh. And we can, using the kind of data we have, say that of this, on Jyotish Shastra, about 30,000 pertain to mathematics and mathematical astronomy. And that would correspond to some 9,000 source works or texts, like Ilavati, Bijagadesh. We'll discuss that in the end. Okay. So 9,000 source work on astronomy. This is an extraordinarily large number of source works. And this is a small estimate by me that in the last 200 years, we have edited and published only about 450 of these books, 9,000 books. And when it comes to translation, we have only translated and looked at only about 95 of these books. So, in some sense, only 5% of the texts which are aware of, which are in public catalogs, which are somewhere in some library, or which were there in some library when that catalog was printed 50 or 80 years ago. But that is the kind of wide network of knowledge that is still there. And of course, there is no institution of higher learning in India which devotes any time to either training scholars for digitizing, scanning, or studying these scripts, or training scholars in any of the languages in which they are written, let alone teaching them some basic principles of the sciences that these books contain, except for some courses that you have now in IIT Gandhinagar. And there are few courses that are being held in other institutions. But by and large, this has not been any priority of modern India till now. Okay, last two comments, since I wanted to talk of science texts, but I only showed the geographical spread of these texts. So certain philosophical unity that is there in the Indian sciences, I just thought I will place it before you. So there is something which you may call as an Indian approach to scientific knowledge, and it has its own distinct view on the nature of scientific knowledge and on the purpose of scientific knowledge. So, the standard view in Greek civilization was that those sciences had to be pursued which came up with unchanging, absolutely true, eternal laws. And so they concentrated on mathematics, they concentrated on the movement of celestial bodies, which they thought followed that kind of eternal, unchanging mathematical laws, or on harmonics, on music. So these were the standard disciplines. And the science of language was not thought of as a science. Yeah, 5 minutes. In fact, the Greeks give no description of our Sanskrit linguistics, Panini's grammar, though they describe lot of aspects of India. They only mention that India has several languages. But even in a grammar like Panini, where in 4,000 sutras, all the language words, the rules for generation was given, the Indian view was that this is only a method for arriving at the valid words. And one could think of other methods, in the sense that while devising scientific theories, Indians were acutely aware that the data and the corpus of information on which these scientific theories are formulated is indeed very limited compared to the enormity and complexity of the universe with which we are dealing. So they called these methods and procedures as upayas, and said that there need not be too much constraint on this upaya, except that they should conform to our observations. So even in astronomy, different theoretical models were made. And in these models, it was said that if other theoretical formulations give observed results, all right, they can also be used. But it is not that they said our methods are meaningless or fictitious. That's not what they said. They said that these are approximate understandings of reality. Reality is much more complicated. And unlike the quest for true knowledge outside India, especially in the Greek and the inheritors of the Greek civilizations in the modern world, the idea has always been to look for really absolutely true, eternally valid laws of nature. Laws meaning nature has to obey certain principles, and either they are created so by God or it is so by nature, and we as humans have an access to those kinds of principles by which God has created. This was the idea that Descartes or Newton or Galileo would have written in their 17th century works. We don't talk in that language today. But about 200 years earlier, if you open a book on physics, they would have said Newton discovered the laws by which God had created the universe. So this is a very different approach, that seeking for absolutely true laws of nature in scientific domain. Another one is the purpose for which science is to be done is also a very mundane purpose in India. Astronomy was to, you observe the motion of stars. You ask that question, why was astronomy done? Observe the motion of stars to know time, place, location, direction. And of course, if you believed in astrology, use it in astrology. Grammar, the purpose was not to understand the nature of human mind. The purpose was, here is a language that we are using. So how do we derive all the known words of the language from certain basic rules? In medicine, the idea was not to know how life differs from every other forms of matter, but to see how to see that healthy people remain healthy and how diseases have to, I mean, the focus is kept on that. It is not that they did not have any theoretical speculations on all those other ideas, but the focus was this, and this was kept the focus all through. And if some other need arose, they would keep the focus there also. Whereas I think the idea of trying to control the universe, or idea of trying to unravel the secret of the universe, is a very different quest which has characterized many other civilizations. So if there is a civilizational unity of knowledge in India, it's both as regards its nature and the purpose for which. And so the Indian approach to scientific knowledge is something that's pragmatic, and it's open-ended, that, and it is grounded in applications. So these are the kind of broad contours. I mean, anyway, whenever you give that kind of a statement, you should always remember that it's a very approximate statement. We are trying to arrive at some broad canvas in which we can put it together. So there will, of course, be Indian works which would have talked in the same way as Ptolemy had done, or Indian scientists who might have talked in the same language as Newton, though they might not have discovered the laws that Newton discovered. Thank you very much.